very much for that kind introduction. Can I just say welcome to everybody who is here tonight? It's great to look across the audience and see people of different ages. We've got some children in here who are trying to learn some lessons. And we've got people representing different segments of the population. We've got people from government, from schools, from the university, also some people representing community groups and professional associations and even families and themselves. So the aim of today's presentation is to report the results of Australia's first report card on physical activity for children and young people. Now I'm going to start by talking a little bit about physical activity. I'll define it and I'll talk about why it's good for us. And then I'll briefly touch upon the development of the report card. After that, I'm going to dive a little more deeply, and we're going to look at about four or five of the key indicators that we assign grades to. I'll start off by looking at the measures and some key statistics that we use to come up with those grades. I'll then make some comparisons with our grades to some countries around the world to see where we're leading and where we're lagging, and I'll wrap each section up by providing some tips, some advice on what we might do next to improve the grades. I'll finish this presentation by providing some key insights and some big ticket take-home messages. So to start off, let's just define physical activity. And in a very simple form, physical activity is any bodily movement produced by the skeletal muscles that results in energy expenditure. So it includes, you know, occupational and household activities like chores. It includes active play and active transportation. And it also includes more formal, structured, and systematic forms of activity like exercise and sport. Now, activity is an important indicator of not only how healthy you are now, but how healthy you will be in the future. People who are more active generally have better health. They have healthier hearts, healthier bones, healthier muscles, better mental health, so they are less depressed, have a better mood status, have better self-esteem and a better health-related quality of life, and also typically function better cognitively. So those who are more active tend to perform better academically. Now, the World Health Organization ranks physical inactivity as the fourth most important risk factor for global health, responsible for about 6% or 3.2 million deaths globally every single year. And in Australia, it is the fourth leading or highest risk factor for reducing Australian productivity, behind smoking, high blood pressure and obesity. Now, recent estimates have put the cost of physical inactivity to the Australian economy at about $13.8 billion per year, with money spent due to healthcare costs, lost productivity, and also early deaths or premature deaths. So we know physical activity is important, and because children are the youngest segment of the population, we are interested in trying to give them the healthiest start to life as possible. So it was important for us to try to describe the current state of play, and that was the fuel behind the report card. Now, the report card is a translation of knowledge. It is a summary of the best available scientific evidence on the physical activity and sedentary behaviours of young Australians. But it's also a summary of the influences, the settings and sources, and also the strategies and investments which have the potential to impact those behaviours. Now, led by the University of South Australia, we got together a group of key researchers, 24 leading researchers from around Australia, from 10 universities and research institutes, to form a research working group. And it was that research working group that decided on the measures and also the systematic process by which we would assign grades using national level data that were benchmarked to a standardised grading framework. So the report card provides a robust and comprehensive assessment of the physical activity of young Australians. And this screen shows the grading framework that we use. So we assigned a grade of A if we are succeeding with a large majority of young Australians who are meeting or satisfying that benchmark. And we assigned a grade of F if very few young Australians are actually meeting that benchmark. But in order to see how well Australia is doing in promoting and facilitating physical activity opportunities. 9 of the 12 indicators that we assign grades to were compared to grades from 14 other countries around the world, using the same standardised process and grading framework. And this screen shows those 14 other countries and also Australia. So you see countries from Oceania, the Americas, Europe and Africa were represented. Now, the theme for this year's report card was, is sport enough? We thought this was a very interesting question, an important question to ask, because Australia is a sporting nation and sport plays an integral part in our national identity. In fact, international sporting success is the number one indicator of national pride. And that is over and above achievements in science and technology, arts and literature, and even economic achievements. So given this national focus, it makes sense that we see a large majority of young Australians participating in organised sport. Now, organised sport provides opportunities for young Australians to be active and also confers a number of benefits. Take, for example, Kobe, our young taekwondo player over here. Now, Kobe participates in taekwondo several times a week. And by participating in taekwondo, he develops a range of physical, motor, and social skills. Now, physically speaking, he develops his strength, his power, his flexibility, his balance, and his coordination. In terms of his motor skills, he develops his locomotor skills and his ability to control objects, like moving out of the way of a flying punch or a kick. And socially, it helps develop his self-discipline, and he has to work within the rules that the instructor sets. Thank you, Kobe. As another example, take our young basketballer, Jordan, here. Now, Jordan participates in basketball on most days of the week, both as part of school and club commitments. Now, he also develops a range of physical, motor and social skills, but sometimes they overlap with the skills that Kobe develops, and sometimes they're a little bit different. Jordan develops his power, his speed, his agility, his ability to quickly change directions, but also, to a greater extent than Kobe, develops his aerobic capacity, his ability to perform prolonged and exhaustive exercise. He also has to master some object control skills as he manoeuvres down the court, dribbling, passing or shooting a basketball. But unlike Kobe, who works independently, Jordan works collaboratively. He has to work as part of a team. He's also a competitive basketball player, so he has to follow the instructions of his coach and work within the rules that the referees administer. Thank you very much, Jordan. So despite the large participation rates in organised sport and the associated benefits, it appears that sport is not enough. Not enough as a sole outlet for physical activity, because participation rates in other forms of activity, like active transportation, are low and are declining. So the broad message from this year's report card is that sport is not enough. So how are we tracking? How are we tracking in terms of our overall physical activity levels? Well, in order to answer this question, we measured the proportion of young Australians who meet the recommended Australian physical activity guidelines that were advertised earlier this year. Now, these guidelines recommend that 2 to 4-year-olds should accumulate at least 180 minutes of activity of any intensity every day, and that children aged 5 to 17 should accumulate at least 60 minutes of that moderate to vigorous activity every day. And this is the activity that leaves you somewhat to substantially tired. Incidentally, for us adults in the room, the government guidelines recommend that we should accumulate at least 30 minutes of moderate to vigorous activity on at least 5 days per week. But what do the key statistics show? Well, they show that about 3/4 of the 2 to 4-year-olds meet that daily recommendation of at least 180 minutes. But only about 15 to 19% of the 5 to 17-year-olds meet that daily recommendation of 60 minutes. So does that mean that the recommendation is simply too tough? It's beyond our reach? Well, not quite. We're close, just not quite close enough, because on average, the young children and old children meet the guidelines on 6 and 4 days every week, respectively. But because we've got one group representing a small slice of children doing reasonably well, and another group representing a large slice of children doing really poorly, we assigned a grade of D- to overall physical activity. Now, how do we compare to our peers overseas? Well, this screen shows the rank order of grades from those 15 countries for which grades were assigned for overall physical activity. And you see Australia is lagging at the bottom of the field with less than half of its children satisfying the physical activity guidelines. Now, there's some interesting observations that can be gleaned from this screen. First of all, it seems that the richest countries, the developed nations like Australia, Canada, and US have very poor grades, whereas the poorer countries, the underdeveloped and the developing countries like Mozambique, Mexico, Kenya, and Nigeria, are doing reasonably well with high grades. Another interesting observation is New Zealand, which is leading the world, sitting right at the very top. And as an Aussie, I don't like losing to Kiwis in anything, and it certainly pains me to see them sitting at the top of this figure. But rather than sook about it, maybe there's some lessons that could be learned from our neighbours across the ditch. So we may need to explore them in the future. But how can we improve this D- grade for overall physical activity? Well, one way is we need to increase public awareness around the new physical activity guidelines. I simply don't think that they're widely known. And we need to widely disseminate this message through national messaging campaigns, through social media and public health care. And we need to also offer up some individualised and family-based physical activity solutions to give people the strategies to which they can meet the guidelines. Another suggestion is to focus on all of the benefits of physical activity, not just weight management. I think weight management and physical activity have often been badged together for a long time, and that's fine. It does have benefits for weight loss and weight management. But physical activity also confers a range of other benefits, like it improves your overall health, the health of your heart, your bones and muscles, for example. Another suggestion is to increase the awareness around how the daily routine can be altered to increase physical activity levels. And here I'm talking about looking at other ways we can be active, like active transportation, that human-powered transportation like walking, cycling or skateboarding. What about active play? Sometimes we as parents need to almost take a step back and have a less is best policy and let kids just play, explore, forage and find out things for themselves. We can have family-based physical activity and also encourage incidental activity like chores. One thing that I think works really well, at least from my perspective as a parent, as an educator and as a coach, is to encourage children to snack on physical activity and try to accumulate it in bite-sized chunks throughout the day. And the reason why I say this is because children, they tend to be very short burst and intermittent in nature. They burst for, say, 5 to 30 seconds, then they rest. Then they burst again, rest again, and they repeat that cycle and over and over. But we as adults, we tend to be reasonably continuous. So if we can tap into those natural physical activity patterns of kids by encouraging them to achieve bite-sized chunks lasting 5 to 10 minutes in multiple bouts during the day, then we're more likely to maximise the buy-in and getting them to adhere to the guidelines rather than asking them to dine in on a big chunk of activity. Now, what about organised sport? Now, you're probably guessing from the theme of the report card that Australia is doing pretty well since we asked the question, is sport enough? And you'd be right. But we tried to measure organised sport by looking at the proportion of young Australians who participate in organised sport and or physical activity programs. Now, the statistics show that there is a general trend towards an increase of sports participation over time, which seems to be witnessed in both Australia and overseas. We also see the national level statistics indicate that 2/3 of 5 to 17-year-olds participated in organised sport in the period over 7 days from which they were surveyed. About 2/3 to 3/4 of these children participated in organised sport within the 12-month period from when they were surveyed. And we see about 85% of kids participated in organised sport during the summer and winter terms, both inside and outside of school. Now, given that more than half of our children are participating in organised sport, we assigned a grade of B-. Now, how do we stack up against the rest of the world? Well, we're doing pretty well here. We're leading the rest of the world with New Zealand because more than half of our children are enrolled and play organised sport. But we can still do better. And one way we could do better is trying to produce effective programs that encourage participation and minimise dropout from organised sport. Now, statistics show that about 12% or 300,000 children will drop out from organised sport between the ages of 10 and 12, and it is likely that these dropout rates will be higher as children age. Now, one strategy to try to minimise the dropout rates is to get children to play sport without the accumulation of competition points. And this strategy is certainly being trialled in Australian rules football and also soccer. And the idea behind it is it reduces the stress and anxiety associated with competitive sport. And it's also likely to shift the focus towards the development of foundational motor skills and increase motivation. Another possible strategy is to improve the affordability of and access to organised sports, particularly in disadvantaged groups, so we can have equitable access to good quality sporting programs. One strategy is to focus more on interscholastic sports where kids have equitable access, or to try to reduce the costs associated with club or district sports, or to increase community sporting programs in our disadvantaged or low SES areas. We also need to have good quality physical education, particularly in the primary school years. And one way to do that is to have specialist PE teachers teaching PE, because they're more likely to foster those sport-related outcomes like increasing physical activity levels, increasing fitness, and increasing foundational motor skills that are likely to lead to increased motivation and people participating. And finally, we should ensure that the sporting games and activities maximise opportunities for movement. So we want to try and maximise both the quantity and also the quality, in other words, the intensity of the physical activity, particularly in practice sessions. Now, another indicator we assigned grades to was active transportation. And remember, that's that human-powered transportation like walking, jogging, running, cycling, skateboarding, or even a little bit of a push scooter where we move from one place to another in bouts of at least 5 to 10 minutes. We measured this indicator as the proportion of young Australians travelling to and from school using active transportation at least one time per week. And the national statistics show that there is a general decline in active transportation or the use of active transportation, not only in Australia, but also overseas in both developed and developing nations. And while this seems to be a less popular mode of transport over recent decades, we understand that because there is a much higher reliance nowadays on motorised forms of transport. Our statistics show that 1 in 5 secondary school students use active transportation to and from school each week, and about 1 in 3 primary school students rely on active means of transport. And this equates to kids achieving about 18 minutes of active transportation per day. But because less than half of our kids are using active modes of transport, we assigned a grade of D to this indicator. But how do we go relative to the rest of the world? Well, a bit of a sad story, I'm afraid. Just like with overall physical activity levels, Australia is lagging behind many of its peers from overseas. But we can improve this grade. And one way we can do it is to take a bit of a hand-holding or combined effort amongst parents, schools, communities and governments. And we need this to increase the physical activity levels of Australians through active transportation. not just to and from school, but to and from other destinations like parks and playgrounds, shops and community centres. So we need to have these policies in place, and we need every single one of these stakeholders to have a say. You know, parents and schools can encourage walking and cycling to school. Schools can allow for early arrivals. They can have vehicle-free zones. They can promote walking school buses. Our communities can look at the local infrastructure and see if it can be tweaked and massaged a little bit to facilitate more walking and cycling. And governments can put policies in place, road policies in place, for cycle paths and also pedestrian priority areas. We also need to develop strategies to overcome parental concerns about traffic and personal safety and, where possible, increase children's competence to use active transportation. And this is going to take a multi-level approach. You know, one thing we could do is we could make sure that our neighbourhoods are a little safer, and for kids, they can more easily negotiate traffic. So, for example, we can make sure we've got good crossing infrastructure and crossing guards, particularly near schools. We can make sure that we've got low speed limits and traffic calming measures like speed bumps in place, particularly in neighbourhoods where there are schools, parks, playgrounds or community centres. And where possible, improve the quality of footpaths, maybe widen footpaths a little bit and increase the number and quality of cycling lanes. In order to improve children's competence at using active transport, one thing we could get is parents to be more involved and join in with the walking school buses, at least until a certain level of skill or competence is achieved, or get clusters of kids to walk together. Now, we also understand that many kids live outside of the school environment and have to rely on motorised forms of transport, but if they can include active transport for at least part of the trip, then we'll be well on our way to improving this grade. Another indicator we assign grades to was sedentary behaviours. And here we're talking about that still time, where we're sitting or lying down when we're awake. Like if we're watching TV or looking at a computer screen as you are now, or reading a book, or sitting down when we're being transported by car, bus or train. Now, we measured sedentary behaviours as the proportion of young Australians who meet the recommended Australian sedentary behaviour guidelines for screen time. Now, these guidelines recommend that children under the age of 2 should receive no screen time at all. Those who are aged between 2 and 4 should have no more than 1 hour of screen time for entertainment every day. And those aged 5 to 17 years should achieve no more than 2 hours of screen time for entertainment every day. Now, national statistics indicate that about 26% of the young children meet that daily recommendation of 1 hour, no more than 1 hour. 29% of the older children meet the daily recommendation of no more than 2 hours. And this equates to the younger and older children, on average, meeting this daily guideline on 4 to 5 days every week. Now, unfortunately, adherence to the guideline declines with age, where we see 41% of 5 to 8 year olds meeting the guideline, yet only 19% of 15 to 17 year olds. So since we're not tracking well here, with less than half of Australians meeting the guidelines, we assigned a grade of D minus to sedentary behaviours. So how do we stack up against the rest of the world? Well, the sorry tale continues. We are lagging behind the rest of the world, with less than half of our kids meeting those sedentary behaviour guidelines. So we need to improve the grade. We need to make sure that kids are less sedentary every single day. And we can do that by educating, encouraging and supporting strategies to reduce time spent in recreational, sedentary, screen-based activities. We can try to promote those family-based physical activity sessions, because parents are great models and we can role model the appropriate behaviours. We can also limit screen time and sometimes just switch the screens off or take them out of the children's bedroom. We also need to improve the understanding that some sedentary behaviours are associated with significant developmental and health issues, that is, independent of physical activity. You see, you can be sufficiently active but still highly sedentary. And in fact, not all sedentary behaviours are created equal. It seems that some are worse than others. TV, for example, seems to be much worse for your health than other screen-based endeavours like working on a computer, and much worse for your health than sitting down in more productive time by reading a book. Now, this might have something to do with the fact that when kids are sitting down watching TV, they're more likely to be snacking on junk food or exposed to a greater number of junk food ads. Or it might have something to do with their sitting posture and the fact that they're just not using their legs. We also need to explore the possibility of breaking up sedentary time at school, because outside the home environment, the school imposes a lot of sedentary time on children. Things like having active lesson breaks where the whole class gets up and walks around the oval or gets time to play on the gym equipment for a few minutes at a time, multiple times throughout the day, could be one strategy. Or having non-sedentary or active lessons through things like outdoor education, where children are taken outside the classroom and educated on the fly, particularly through movement. Now, while we've looked at the grades assigned to four behaviours, I want to finish off by looking at one key influence, and that is the community and the built environment. We measured this by looking at the proportion of Australian children and parents who report that there is a playground near to their home, and also the proportion of parents who report heavy and problematic traffic not to be an issue in and around their home or school neighbourhood. National statistics indicate that 87% of adolescents and 84% of parents report having a playground that they can access very close to their home. And 3/4 of parents report that heavy or problematic traffic is not an issue in and around the neighbourhood attached to their child's school. So given these statistics, we assigned a grade of A-. And relative to the rest of the world, we are right at the very top. And we're leading the world because we've got very good structures, facilities and equipment in this country that will hopefully facilitate physical activity. But we've still got some room to move. We can bump this up a little bit. We need to ensure that playgrounds are designed and take into account the needs of children of all ages, and making sure that the equipment is age appropriate and appealing. You know, if I look around at some of the playgrounds in near my house, I see, you know, really young children playing there at one park, or really much older children playing at another park, but we don't see too many integrative playgrounds. So we need to make sure that the equipment is appealing to kids of all ages. We also need to make sure that those playgrounds are well maintained and sited within walking distance of families, particularly families with young children, because both walkability to parks and the quality of their park is a good determinants of whether people will actually go to them and use them. And finally, let's think about healthy, active built environments for people of all ages, not just kids. Let's think about widening those footpaths and those cycling lanes. Let's think about lowering the traffic speed limits and having those traffic calming measures in and around neighbourhoods where there are parks and playgrounds. And let's make sure that all of our parks and playgrounds, our community centres, are very well maintained. Now finally, let's just summarise by looking at some key insights that have been learned from the report card. First of all, Australia received good grades and is leading in terms of organised sport and community in the built environment. We've got the structures and the facilities and equipment in place, and that fosters good organised sports participation. However, Australia was graded poorly and is lagging behind in overall physical activity and sedentary behaviours. And we need to ensure that we can increase the physical activity levels and make children less sedentary every single day. The broad messages that come from the report card is that sport is not enough, not as a sole outlet of physical activity. And that while we've got the structures in place, we're simply not active enough. We've built it, but they're not coming. Now, this could mean that the environments are not the rate limiting factor. It's not the major determinant. Or it might mean that we're building a bit of a cotton wool culture. We've got a bit of a soft culture now that everything is easy to access, and therefore they're simply not moving to it. So what I'd encourage you to do is think about tweaking your week. Try to throw a little bit of low tech in with your high tech and try to make life a little bit harder. Bring back some of the human elbow grease into your life. And also, we need to reimagine physical activity in a developing technological society, because we won't be able to wind the clock back. We won't be able to wind it back to the 1980s when I was a child, or to the 1950s when my parents were kids, when just about every kid walked or cycled to and from school, and kids were playing in the neighbourhood, out in the street, after school, or at a time when labour-saving devices weren't the norm, even simple things like remote controls. Now, before we finish with some big-ticket item take-home messages, I'd like to bring up my two colleagues, my two co-lead authors on this report card, Professor Tim Olds and Dr. Natasha Schranz. And I would personally like to thank both of them. Tim, I'd like to thank you for your inspiration, and Tash, for your perspiration, because without your help, this report card wouldn't have been possible. And because Tash is probably the hardest working person in this trifecta, I'm going to ask her to bring this presentation home by reporting to you those big ticket item take-home messages.
Thanks, Grant. So throughout the presentation, Grant's pinpointed some specific things that we need to be doing to improve each of the grades independently of one another. But what I'm going to do is take a step back and have a look at that bigger picture and sort of highlight some big ticket items that we need to be doing in order to improve all the grades. Firstly, we need real action at the policy, community, interpersonal and intrapersonal level. So what this could mean is that governments could provide means-tested tax credits or rebates to individuals who are physically active, so by joining the gym, a sporting club or a dance club. We also need a national monitoring system which collects nationally representative data on a regular basis. This system needs to put in place standardised questions and tests, which can then plug directly into the report card core metrics. In this year's report card, the Research Working Group did make recommendations about what those standardised questions and tests should be for each of the grades, or each of the indicators, sorry, and also which core metrics we should use now and in the future to assign grades to each of the indicators. Grant's touched on this briefly, but it's really important that we need to increase public awareness around the new National Physical Activity and Sedentary Behaviour Guidelines through national campaigns and programs. This increase in awareness for children, parents, teachers and other influential people is really important, because it will give them a greater understanding of how much physical activity is needed for healthy development, growth and well-being, as well as how they can accumulate this physical activity throughout their day. The 2014 Physical Activity Report Card by Active Healthy Kids Australia clearly shows that there is still a lot of work that needs to be done to improve the overall physical activity levels of Australian children. While Grant highlighted some specific things that need to be done to improve individual grades, we need to take a step back and look at that bigger picture and implement some of the strategies that I've just outlined if we want to see a real change in the overall physical activity behaviours of Australian children and youth. Thank you.
Thanks, Tash. And just to finish off, there's some people and groups that we would like to thank. We'd particularly like to thank our primary and secondary strategic and endorsing partners, the National Heart Foundation and Exercise and Sports Science Australia. We'd also like to thank the Research Working Group, because they were the people who helped us identify the measures and put the systematic process in place to assign the grades to those key indicators. And finally, we would like to thank the University of South Australia's Sansom Institute for Health Research for hosting this event, in particular Pat Buckley and her team, Kelly and Kate, and also UniSA Media and Marketing for promoting this event. Thank you very much.